We're back at our cabin energy performance improvement project. And in this video, we're going to take a hard look at the roof because there's a couple of vulnerable areas that need to be better insulated and air sealed. When we looked at this roof assembly, we noticed a couple of problems right away. And to start with, you know, this is a cathedral ceiling framed with 2x10 rafters. And right here where these rafters come down on our 2x6 exterior walls, there's been a bird's mouth cut in. And to complicate matters, our floor joists also run in, and in many cases, they're sistered against the rafters. Makes for a strong roof. It also makes this incredibly difficult to air seal and insulate properly. When you looked, there is 2x6 blocking here, and there's a vent space, and that's good. But that displaces even more room for insulation in this vulnerable area right here where the roof meets the walls. I mean, I'd say best case, if we were insulating this with fiberglass bats, we might get R21 in here. And that's just insufficient for this roof. We're risking a lot of heat loss right through to the roof deck. The other problem that happens when roofs are framed like this and they're so complicated is it's virtually impossible to air seal them with anything but spray foam. You can see the previous owner, he tried to caulk all the wood joints here to keep the air leakage to a minimum, but the caulking will fail eventually. Sometimes it fails really quickly. And you can't really do it well with a vapor retarder. You can see here there's a vapor retarder on the wall. And if this vapor retarder were to come up and try to seal this joist bay against these rafters, you'd have to cut slots and tabs and try to caulk this, and that never works either. So hands down, the best application for insulating this roof is spray applied foam. And our solution to do this is we're going to put a couple of cleats in every bay that give us a minimum of 1.5 inches airspace. And then we've got some 3/8 plywood, and that plywood slides all the way down and protects this vent space from getting filled with the spray foam when it gets sprayed. The other issue here, though, is the spray foam will just boil over, and we will not be able to tie our sealing vapor retarder in here right at this transition. So we need to be able to capture that spray foam. And the way we're going to do that is we are going to install a row of blocking right along a chalk line that snapped along the bottom of the rafters. And when this is installed, then we can seal our vapor retarder along the bottom here. And all of this area can be filled with spray foam, which will radically boost the air sealing and the amount of insulation we can get in here. I want to take a short detour here and take a closer look at this transition area as seen from underneath. And at this point, the wall vapor retarder has been installed. It's sealed along the double top plate, and it's clamped by this 2x2 here. So the walls are done. But look how complicated this gets when a roof is framed like this. You've got your floor joists acting as collar ties. They're intersecting your rafters. And you have a subfloor here, and somehow you have to be able to transition with a good air seal and adequate insulation to your roof insulation. And remember, this is a fairly shallow roof, so we don't have a lot of room for insulation here. So spray foam is simply the best option. And if we don't get enough insulation in here and we have an air leak, our ice dam risk goes way up. So this is the way to do it right. In addition, you can see over here, this is another difficult area to air seal and insulate, and that's this gable end bay. Once again, all of this can get filled with foam and give us a very robust air seal. Now let's take a look at the roof insulation. You can see where the new owner has installed a row of blocking right here at the bottoms of the rafters, where the rafters transition to the floor assembly. And remember, the spray foam company is going to insulate every rafter bay and spray up against the backside of this blocking. So it will be air sealed very thoroughly. And what we'll be left with then is a continuously supported band of wood here where we can apply our acoustical sealant and our plastic vapor retarder on the ceiling and get a very robust air seal at this transition from our roof to our floor assembly. Also, when you take a look here, you can see that we ended our plywood baffle and switched to a plastic baffle. And the reason for us using a plywood baffle in the first place is the only plastic baffles available to us in Fairbanks are the type that don't have additional support here in the center. And if we sprayed foam against a baffle like this, the expanding foam would crush this vent space. And so consequently, we've put the plywood in the first section that gets spray foamed, and then we've transitioned to the plastic baffles. And the reason we're going to so much effort to maintain a continuous inch and a half vent space all the way from our soffit to our ridge is that this roof for Climate Zone 8 is under insulated, and we're doing the best we can with the budget we have to get the thermal performance up and putting ventilation in that our ice dam risk is pretty low. Remember, if we have too great a heat losses through this roof assembly, we risk thawing the snow that's on top of the roof. And that's a worst case scenario for us. When we have continuously baffled vent space like this, it has another benefit because now our fiberglass insulation, A, it's not at risk for plugging the vent space because there's a very clear separation here. But the other thing is, when you have ventilation air in a situation like this passing over fibrous insulations, these insulations won't perform as well. And so having this continuous barrier ensures that our insulation actually performs as rated. The other performance improvement we're doing here with this roof assembly is we're adding 2 inches of EPS foil-faced insulation across the entire underside of the rafters. And remember, this roof is framed 16 inches on center. They're 2x10s. There's a lot of solid wood in this roof assembly and not a whole lot of insulation. And so adding 2 inches of foam board across rafters like this greatly reduces heat losses through thermal bridging and the potential ice dam risk we get on the roof deck. People sometimes ask, you know, should I face my foil towards the room or towards the insulation cavity? That only comes into play should you happen to have an airspace in front of your foil facer. In this case, our foam is held on by 2x4s, and this will become a wiring chase. And so, yes, we do have an airspace. It makes sense since this foam does have a foil facer, we face it towards the room, and we'll probably pick up a point or two in R value. By the numbers, this roof now performs at an R38. And while that doesn't meet current state energy code or energy code recommendations of R48, it's still a solid performing roof in terms of keeping ice dam risk at a minimum. As always, thanks for watching, and we welcome all your questions and comments.